to love or hate Facebook, but it can be quite awesome when you add someone you admire, exchange a few messages, and have no idea that you will meet them soon. The first poster I saw by Luba Lukova was when I was still in Iran. It was an African-American face with an open mouth and nutrition label inside it. That was an enough introduction to her work, or better to say, to her world. Inspired by Greek art, simple but powerful flat colors and black shapes with white lines conquer the blurry line between dreams and reality. She employs metaphor, juxtaposes symbols, and uses minimal text to best capture the essence of dignity and humanity. Luba Lukova is called an image maker, a graphic designer, illustrator, and social activist. In her work, she deals with social justice, peace, censorship, immigration, ecology, hunger, and corruption. As you can imagine, she has been widely recognized by leading institutions and organizations worldwide, like UNESCO and MoMA. Please join me in welcoming Luba Lukova.
Okay, thank you so much for coming and sacrificing this beautiful afternoon to be here with me. I'm really happy to and honored to present my work at the Penny Stamp Series, and I would like to thank Christina Hamilton for inviting me. Thanks to Penny Stamps for sponsoring the event. Thanks to Parisa for the beautiful introduction, and to Nicola Books for contacting me and offering my social justice posters. Today, thanks for the folks at the theater who made this beautiful setting here possible, and thank you all for coming. I would like to ask the technician to kind of reduce a little bit the lights because they're just in my face, if you don't mind, if that's possible. Just a little bit, if that's possible. I don't know if they hear me, but anyway, I was told to give you an informal presentation and like a very spontaneous talk about my work, and that's what I always do. I've never done a formal presentation. So I will go through my pictures and I will speak about the process, about the ideas, what inspired them, and talk about my relationship with clients who commission work, because I do commission work as well. And I'll be happy to answer your questions after the lecture. So let me start. Adjust a little bit. I don't think we can reduce the light a little bit. No? Okay. Okay. So this one I did last year. I had an exhibition in Alabama, in Birmingham. And last year, 2013, we honored the 50th anniversary of the civil rights movement. And I dedicated my exhibition to what happened 50 years ago in Alabama and to the movement inspired by Martin Luther King. And you see that in my work, I use a lot of simple images. But that's not simple to do, you know. Less is more, but only if you know how to work with it. So if you see in this one, the only colors I use are red, black, and a little bit of white, but I think the white is what makes the whole image speak, because the silhouette of Dr. King is holding peacefully I have a dream, and the other white accent is the teeth of these dogs. So this juxtaposition tells it all. Dr. King opposed the oppression in a peaceful way, and he asked the young people down in Alabama to sit on chairs and to express their disagreement with the oppression in that very meaningful but very peaceful way, and the reaction was exactly the opposite. So I like in my work the contrast, and I use it in every possible way, and this one is also inspired a little bit by, not a little bit entirely, by what we know about the history of the United States in the South. You see on the first look, you see somebody playing the harmonica, playing the blues. But when you look a second longer, you realize that the background is the hands of the cotton picker. Again, the contrast and the meaning, how beauty and art usually comes from the pain. That's true not only for what happened in the South and the slavery, but probably throughout, you know, the entire human experience. That's what makes art possible. The struggle creates beauty. And that was also for an exhibit I did in the Mississippi Delta. I do a lot of work that people label me as a political artist, and I've never liked that. I'm not a political person in the sense that I've never belonged to a political party or a movement. I just react to what happens in the world just like an ordinary person, but I learn how to draw, and that's my language. And this image is dedicated to the 25th anniversary of the Chernobyl disaster, if you remember, when the atomic plant exploded and killed a lot of people and completely changed the landscape in Ukraine. And exactly at that time, we had another disaster, which was in Fukushima. So basically, the image happened to unite both events. And even if they were 25 years apart, they were quite similar and devastating in both places when they happened. And I know that here in the audience there are art and design students, and I often get questions from young artists, how do you come up with ideas? That usually happens when I try to think deeply about the issue. And in this case, I was thinking, what happened in Ukraine 25 years ago happens now, and it's as powerful and as devastating. And we claim that we have advanced so much and we have conquered nature, but a small, simple thing as the atom still is able to kill us. And then I thought to myself, atom, that's what the ancient Greeks gave us, the idea of the smallest particle. And then when I started thinking about the ancient Greek, I thought about this classical sculpture of Laocoon and his sons, and I replaced the snakes, if you remember that from art history, and just put the atomic model, and it worked perfectly. I just did a little, like a few small adjustments, but there was a message by, you know, combining elements and replacing them, but it's all a mental process. And surprisingly, it worked well, and there was the message. And that's what I wanted to say, that humanity is vulnerable, no matter how we think about ourselves, but we are still vulnerable, and we can never probably conquer or understand completely the power of nature. But back to reality, as Parisa said, we were first friends on Facebook. And I have no idea why, but I have thousands of followers from Iran and from people in surrounding countries also, like in Asia. And once somebody asked me from these friends on Facebook, are you going to address the women's rights? And I said to myself, yes, let me try to do that and do really more serious work. And I came up with this triptych where I wanted to speak about women's rights, but not in that heroic feminist way, the way we speak here in the West, where we fight really or the way the generations of the 60s and 70s did it, because I'm in a privileged situation being younger than the people in the 60s, and we live in a much better world now. But for the people in countries like Iran, the situation is different. But the way I approached it, I wanted to depict situations of ordinary, everyday life, and then speak about gender inequality in these everyday situations. So this one is eating ice cream. You cannot even eat ice cream if you are covered completely like that. This one is fun in the sun. I've seen this happening, but I kind of made a twist on the tourist poster that we will see here in a resort in the Western world where a couple is playing on the beach. And for one person, he's showing off his body. And I posted that on Facebook, and there were some negative comments that this is not how men look. And I said, but this is not how American men look. Michael Phelps maybe looks like that, but the average American man doesn't look like that. But it's exaggerated to emphasize the lack of freedom for the woman. And the third one is somebody taking photograph maybe of his sisters or his wives and says, say cheese with the smartphone. So that's that. Then, like I said, I create all these images completely inspired by my own thoughts on the situations in life, but often I'm approached by different organizations who had seen my work and they feel that I'm the right artist for their cause. And this was for an organization in Greece who put a campaign on immigration, and they approached different artists from international artists and asked us to express something to this issue. And I thought about this myth that the immigrants take the jobs of the locals. And in Greece, I was told that the local people are really very unfriendly towards these migrants from Africa or from the Middle East who do the dirtiest jobs in Greece, and the locals still hate them. So that's my answer. You know, they don't take our jobs. They do the jobs that no one else wants to do. Something for the War Resisters League in New York. I am doing a lot of work for them, and they also publish a really nice magazine called Win. And I was just asked actually to become sort of a creative director for this publication and be responsible for their covers. But this is one cover 2 years ago dedicated on war and education. So you see here the metaphorical twist, the bump becomes a sharpening tool for the pencil. So I guess the message is clear. This is the cover of this publication that Nicola Books has in the lobby. In 2008, I just thought to myself that I've done so much work for different social causes, but there are issues that I've never been able to address or approach, and why not try to publish that? And I started my small publishing, and the first publication was this Social Justice 2008. And I put the date because at that time we were all so enthusiastic and inspired by the Obama campaign, and I personally hoped that many of these issues will be resolved in the first months of Obama's presidency. But you see now that almost everything that's included in this book is still, makes sense, and it's completely up to date for what we face now. Unfortunately, they're still relevant. Media, the brainwashing, this image, I mean, I can tell you. Also, when I decided to publish this and to become a publisher, I mean, it sounds so huge that I was a little scared who is going to understand that and who will have any interest in that. But I was so blown away and surprised by the interest from so many different countries. Right now, this is in Paris, in a festival, and it amazes me that 6 years after it's been released in a place like France, they understand the message and the meaning, but also in other places. This is on the social security system, how there's not going to be enough funds for that for the younger generations, and how they keep trying to exhaust this system by spending the money for other reasons. Another image relating to immigration. I was not trying to judge what is illegal or legal immigration, but just to say that an immigrant is someone who grows from a different tree, like being grafted into a different culture and contributes to the growth. Privacy, this also is so relevant now. And I did it as a reaction to this Patriot Act when the government was given the right to spy on us. We didn't have Snowden or any of the whistleblowers back then, but you see, it still makes sense 6 years back from then. This is the image that Parisa mentioned, which is called Sudan. And if you see inside the nutrition label, all the ingredients are 000. And I thought that if we talk about social justice, this is not only for this country or for any country, because the world is so interdependent and interconnected. If we keep poverty and starvation in one part of the world, that creates danger for the so-called Western world. The inequality breeds anger and greed and envy and all these negative emotions that lead to terrorism and so many other disasters in the contemporary world. So I felt like Sudan needs to be part of that. But a little history back for this image and maybe a little bit of background about me in connection with this image. When I came to this country, my first job was to do illustrations for the New York Times for the book review, and then I switched to the op-ed page. And it was back in the 90s when the paper was doing much better than now. But then there was an editor who was asking the artists to contribute or to suggest ideas for the op-ed page. And I remember watching a documentary about Sudan, and they were showing these starving people, almost like moving skeletons. And after the film, there was a commercial for some low-calorie food. And immediately I thought about this as an image. I quickly made it like a collage, did sketched it, and faxed it to the paper, but the editor felt like it was not in the news and all that, so it was never used as a drawing for the paper. But then an organization called International Anti-Poverty Law Center approached me, and they asked me to do their identity, and I showed them this image, and they loved it, and it became a poster, and then I included it in this portfolio. So just to give you an idea how, for the young students and designers here who often ask me to how to start, from where to start, from anywhere, you know, you just have to be like an antenna, open to everything that happens, get inspiration from life, and use your skills to make a message. So there is no formula from where to start, but you have to really care about this world, and then people will come to you, because our profession is very necessary. I don't think technology or just this seemingly cool stuff, new social media or this or that, I don't think that really gives the answers that are necessary or what is important in life, but rather that moral compass that each of us has. That's what is important and necessary. The social media can only help to spread the message. So don't get, I think, fooled that the technology replaces the values in life and that the technology itself solves problems. It's the compassion, the emotion, and the ideas that come from the person, not from the technology. So that's my little message. I teach a little bit at Pratt Institute, and my students know my speech because I give that very often to the students. But just to you, just to give you a little bit of kind of my philosophy about technology and art and that interdependence. But this image was also part of the portfolio, and at that time I was thinking, oh, Obama will fix that in a couple of months, and you see it took so many years, and still now we have some improvement. Obamacare is not perfect, but it's a step forward. And I was very proud when I published the portfolio. It became popular on the internet. The Obama campaign saw that, and they wanted this poster at his first inauguration in Washington, D.C. So I'm happy that, you know, in a small way, an image kind of directed the attention to the big issue. Censorship, I don't need to speak much, but censorship is always painful. When you are not allowed to express yourself, it always hurts. Ecology, when we destroy nature, we destroy ourselves. War is not the answer. That, again, same play with positive, negative, like in the blues poster. Instead of creating wars, we need to find a way to communicate. corporate corruption, the executive chair grabbing the money. And at that time, when I was doing that, there was the scandal with Enron, but how many more corporate corruption scandals after that? So again, this image still relevant 6 years after I was published it. This one became also one of the very popular images of the portfolio, also published in many countries, viral on the internet, before even the Occupy movement. I mean, I've seen it also used by the Occupy movement in Washington, D.C. and in New York, but I don't have to explain about the 1% that controls 95% of the wealth and, you know, the rest of us having a little piece from the big pie. This image also is part of the collection piece, and you see that the silhouette of the dove is made out of the little symbols of war. This was also published first in the New York Times as a drawing for an article on when the US got involved in the Balkan conflict a few like years ago in the 90s. And since then also it's been republished so many times, even published on the back of this guy who is a history student from Baltimore and who sent me this picture. Here on the facade of the War Resisters League is a banner that falls in the night and it's lit from the building inside and it's lifted up in the morning. That's in their new building. Here another fun application. I was asked by the Frankfurt Fair in Germany to participate in an experimental show transforming everyday objects, and I called it War and Peace Accessories for the Contemporary Bathroom, and I put my posters on the toilet seats like that. So, and when I first published the set, I was asked to exhibit it at the Art Institute of Boston, and I was thinking how to present that, because I dislike to show my pictures on the wall. I always try to find a concept for the show, and I thought about using these big umbrellas, because a lot of the images show something which has, the content has been removed from it, and kind of echo the health coverage poster, so that's the installation in the gallery. All these images that I showed you, plus maybe the same amount of new work and also sketches and process will be published in this new book that I've been working on for a couple of years already, Graphic Guts, where I explain about the process and the sketching and the back and forth and the coming up with ideas. So that's the cover, Catching the Bull by the Horns, and the horns become the pencils, that the tool of the artist. But besides the political stuff, which I never call political, I call it really like, I don't know, social activism or something that matters to me. So I'm sorry I used the word political anyway. But besides that, I do a lot of work that is inspired by other art forms, music, theater, literature. In this case, I was asked to do the packaging design for Ella Fitzgerald and Duke Ellington concerts on the Côte d'Azur, a package of 8 CDs, jazz. And I took the plastic box and printed one element of the image on the CD and another one male on the plastic. And when you rotate the CD, you come up with different combinations all the time. So kind of mimicking the improvisational nature of jazz. And because it was Ella and Duke, it was always male, female. And in the booklet inside, I used the male and female and introduced the theme of the sea because it was all on the Mediterranean Sea. So this collection is this. And happy to say it was nominated for a Grammy for a best design. But it's all inspired by the music and by the sea, basically. And theater-inspired work, Shakespeare, The Taming of the Shrew. Again, for the students here, the way I do graphic design, I feel, especially when it's related to other art forms, and especially when it's related to the theater, I try to do everything by hand, because theater is this art form where live people perform in front of us, so I feel the design should kind of capture that imperfection or all the surprises that live performance has. And this poster is entirely done by hand, and the S of the letters mimic the ponytail of the woman, kind of emphasizing the idea of taming. And to give you an idea of my sketch process, I do a lot of little drawings like that, especially when the text is so inspirational as Shakespeare, and you can see a new idea in almost every page. So drawings like this, sketches, maybe something interesting will come from all these little doodles, and I will pick two or three, make them a little bigger, a little bit more elaborate, and I show them to the person who has commissioned me, and we go from there. But for my sketchbook, I do a lot of things like that, and I absolutely enjoy the process because I learn a lot with every project, with everything I have to read. Even if I don't use the idea I generated, I have a lot of little folders with sketches, and I often flip back and forth and maybe use it for something else. So that's, I think, how you generate ideas, when you constantly draw and sketch. So again, I encourage everybody to do that, to keep it like a visual diary. And sometimes there are books and publications that are interested in the drawings, and this was a really nice publication done by Moleskine and the Italian Cultural Trust, where they published sketches of artists, and they auctioned them then to help to restore some Italian historic sites. Another work for the theater, I've done a lot of posters for this theater company in New York called La Mama, experimental stuff, but very often inspired by Greek mythology or the world mythology. In this case was 7 plays that I united by handwriting the titles as the hair of this Greek profile. Another one for them, an evening of a couple of short plays together. And because all of them were about humanity, so I did this fabric of humanity when I took different characters from the place and intertwined them together. This is very recent. I do also work with this company too for many years, for 15 years, Theater 3 Collaborative. I also design sets and videos, but only in collaborations like this where I know the other artists very well and we trust each other. So this was a great play telling the story of one of these big Wall Street moguls who think that they control the world and they profit from the war. And in the end, he is destroyed, and his daughter is, and a good prevails in the face of his daughter and a couple of other characters. So these are symbolized by the birds. So that's his angry face dictating, giving orders. This is one of the moments of towards the end of the play with the images on these panels. That's when he's dying and goes to heaven. But if you see in front, is the same chair as the corporate corruption chair. That's exactly the same chair I drew for that poster. And I told you how I started from in New York with these black and white drawings when the New York Times was just a black and white paper. And working for the op-ed page for so many years was a truly great experience because it taught me to work very fast. I always have in me that discipline that I don't have to procrastinate, that if I don't finish something on time, I'll probably never finish it. But when you are kind of forced to work that way by a client who is waiting for you, there is no way back. You know, when you do your personal work, you can always leave it for a day or two. But for jobs like this, they will call at 10 o'clock in the morning. You read quickly the article, or sometimes the article is not even written. And you have to come up with a couple of ideas, fax them back, or now email them, and then finish it by 4 o'clock. So I've done hundreds of these, and like I said, it was a great learning experience because you are exposed to everything what's happening in the moment, and you have to translate it in a simple one color, black and white, or maybe a little bit of gray here and there, image, and capture the essence of the issue. And in many cases, the images spoke stronger than the words. And I do believe that's true. That's why there is a demand for what we do, because the images really make a stronger impact and lasting impact. So the first one was something about the American values overshadowing other cultures. I think it was done when we first invaded Iraq. This is on the healthcare and the money, follow the money. This was a very nice article on a journalist from Panama who challenges the domestic mafia with his articles and how the mafia wants him to stop, but he's like the little David trying to, and in the end he wins, you know. But maybe I don't have enough time, but just to give you an idea about the pressure when you work like this. When I got the job, I was told that it's gonna be a very short piece, and I did the drawing, and then maybe half an hour before I'm due to send the finish, they tell me that the layout has changed because there's not gonna be an advertisement in the page and you have to fill up double the space. And I immediately extended the leg and I filled up the ad, you know. So that made the image so much more powerful because the little guy now is fighting with a big power, but you have to make decisions on the spot. And if you don't have drawing skills, I don't think it's possible to handle jobs like that. So that's another thing that always I push people to really draw. Not to trace, but to draw from your head. And you don't have to be Michelangelo, but just do it from your head, because when you do it like that, you learn something, and you remember it, and it will help you for the next job. So if there are students here who want to be illustrators, drawing is the most important skill that you have to develop. And something similar, because you see here the positive, negative, the profile, and the shoe. Kind of similar idea, but completely different. For a tango performance, the intimate life of tango dancers, you see the negative is the heart and the arrow. And the heart being a cliché, if you use the clichés in an interesting way, you can always come up with something new. This I did around Valentine's Day for something else, but it's like you see the cheese grater and the hearts. This is the cover of Chicago Tribune on Valentine's Day, to love or not, something about the people who are afraid to fall in love. And that's why this guy is spraying the cupids like mosquitoes. He wants to get rid of them, but the little sprays are little hearts again. So just to show you variations on things. Something inspired by jazz music for a jazz club in San Francisco. You see the sax and the highlights of these two lovers. Another one for sunny music, just for lovers. So this is kind of, because we are getting close to Valentine's Day, but yeah, like I love music and I love when projects like this come. And I love also when people approach me with projects like this because they give me freedom. And I most of the time work directly with the other creative people. I do most of stuff for the theater for off-Broadway. This is a Broadway poster, but it was a different story because the director had seen it and he's seen my work and he wanted me to do it. But I've had bad experience with Broadway when there is so many middle people and all these commercial concerns that kill entirely the creativity in many cases. But this wasn't like that. This was for a play about six real musicians who worked in Germany in the 30s. And when the fascism comes, their music is banned and all of their recordings are destroyed because they were all from different backgrounds. So what I wanted to say is that despite that they were different, they were able to create harmony. So that's why I stylized them as three tuning forks. Something for another company in New York, the Living Theater. On how the jazz musicians in the 50s needed the drugs and to be addicted to drugs in order to make the music, and that ruined them. I've done a lot of work for this company and really cherish my collaboration with them. Here is something, a poster for an exhibition I did at La Mama, and I was trying to say that the personality of the artist is in every print that comes from the printing press, and especially saying that if you work as a designer, that's true too, because you may be commissioned by someone, but what you do carries who you are. So that was my idea, to show that our emotions and feelings are in everything we do. And that's a three-dimensional version of the same image done in the gallery with wood. and the prints flying up to the ceiling. It's a real nice piece. Something for the living theater again, a play that was on how the society puts limitation on the individual. And I saw their rehearsal, they were playing with ropes, and I made this parcel of this genderless human being printed on a craft paper just to mimic that packaging feel. Something they did, the Living Theater, a play against the death penalty, they performed on Times Square every time when there was an execution in the US. And I went to the rehearsal and I saw how they were running in circles, screaming, let's break the circle of vengeance, and that gave me the idea for the image. This became a very popular image, but it was actually done as a logo for someone who approached me after one lecture like tonight and asked if, he said, I worked for many years for a big company and now I'm starting something on my own and I need, my company is called Say It Loud, will you do a logo? So that's what I did for him, but people see so much, like different meaning in it, and I'm fine with that because the pictures have their own life. You can't control what people see, and I'm happy when I see people interpret images in different ways. Romeo and Juliet, don't have to explain, the two lovers separated by the hatred of the families. This is an exhibit I did in Colorado and in Fort Collins, and I was thinking how to make the show, and I thought, what are the prints? They're like keys that go from mind to mind and create a bridge and connect people. So I called it the bridge, and I put the prints like one big arch, mimicking like a bridge, and you can go both ways and see the work. Something for a dancer, choreographer with whom I've collaborated also for years. She did the show Dancing with Her Shadow. The shadow was projected behind her on a screen, and with some computer technology, the shadow is moving independently from her, and she's dancing with her shadow. For the same dancers, they found a couple of red chairs and they performed with them. And they were in such beautiful harmony, so I thought about yin and yang and the blend of two parts that match together. So that's for them. Frankenstein, the monster destroying the creator. Very recent one for A Midsummer Night's Dream. This is a company just next to my studio, and I'm doing their entire season now. Adding Machine, a beautiful play talking about a guy who is trapped in his everyday job working on the adding machine. Don Quixote, done by the Living Theater. Something for an exhibition of my own work. I called it War and Peace, and the inspiration came after I saw a short film about these young people who come, the soldiers coming from the first months from Iraq. And you see like a beautiful, healthy human being, and then you look down and you see that they are given these temporary prosthetic legs that look exactly like a cage upside down, and they're learning how to walk with them. And when I saw that, I thought, this is the price we pay for peace, but not all of us pay the same price. So I made that, I put the bird, the symbol of peace, and it's already something else. A poster, theater poster again, dealing with a different war, the Vietnam War, about a soldier who comes back from the war addicted to drugs and how with the help of his Chinese-American wife, he looks back at his childhood and he finds a new direction or optimism to go on with his life. Something about the women in the Muslim world. I did that. The set of illustrators asked me to present work there, and I did that. Something which is my probably one of my most favorite illustration projects. I was asked by a publisher in Chicago to do a book with the biblical stories that the Catholic and also Baptist Church doesn't read on the during the Sunday Mass, so the church basically censors the biblical text. And this is a small selection of these work, which was later published as a portfolio with silkscreened work. But I absolutely enjoyed it because I knew about the biblical characters, but I knew only about the main ones. I never knew that these stories can be so contemporary when you read them, and that you see how even the biblical text was kind of marginalizing women in many cases. So this is Eve. This is Hagar. And the publisher gave me the freedom to draw the biblical characters as I like, you know, every race, every age. Hagar left in the desert like an African mother. This particular story I never knew. It's a woman called Junia, but on one page she's Junia, like a woman. You flip, read the next page, she's Junia, like a man. So obviously who wrote the biblical text was changing her gender just because her actions were not appropriate for a woman. And that's why I put her in this glass box with the male profile. Mary is a black woman with her heart pierced by seven swords. And on the back is Simon with baby Jesus. Mary giving birth. And I don't have to say that the publisher was absolutely supportive, but once this was published, they got a lot of letters of disapproval. But the publisher was really, because some people wrote, this is not true, Mary never felt pain when she was giving birth and all that, but the publisher stood by me, and then it became their best-selling book, and they published the images, like I said, like a portfolio. This is Mary and Joseph, when Joseph is learning that she's pregnant, and he thinks she's a prostitute, and he wants to abandon her, and the angel tells him the story. Rebecca, the foremother, as the source of everything. Ruth and Naomi, and Parisa mentioned, I told her that my greatest inspiration probably is from the Greek art, because I'm so fascinated how this artist drew on the ceramic shape with so very few lines, but they were able to capture movement, character, interaction between the people, like emotion, feeling. So I've studied quite a bit, and this is particularly inspired by that, the hands, the way they lock like that, like a spiral. Song of Songs, another spiral here. I twisted the legs and the necks of the birds and the snakes. And these are the lovers from the Song of Songs, kind of mimicking the model of DNA, like the core of life. So that's the thinking behind this one. Salome is a modern dancer. Her legs frame the friends of John the Baptist, and she's dancing with his head. Sarah, when she is 90-something years old and the angel tells her that she's going to have a child and she can't believe that this is happening to her. Poster for an exhibition I did in Springfield, Missouri. I called it Catch, and I stretched in the gallery a couple of fishing nets and I filled them up with all my sketches, and the idea was to show how difficult it is to catch the idea. So that's the thinking behind this one. Another exhibition I did in Boston, I called it Humanizing Design, and I used for display these perfect tall mannequins with long legs and beautiful necks, and I was trying to say that humanity does not come from the perfect proportions, but from the feelings, from the emotions. So that's why I sandwiched the mannequins with my images. The cover of Time, on the scientists from the Western world who go to the undeveloped countries and they steal from the local people all of their secrets of using plants for healing, and then they come to the West and they license that and make tons of money, and the local people don't know anything about that. The cover of The Village Voice, a paper in New York City, that this was a real nice story about the unions in Chinatown who claim that they protect the lives of the workers in the sweatshops, but they do exactly the opposite. So that's why I did this monster out of the sewing machine going through the body of the worker. Something, I'm doing a lot of work for this other company in Los Angeles, Odyssey Theater, Lorca, Blood Wedding, dealing with, you know, the issues of, again, equality for women and freedom. So It's a long story, but again, the juxtaposition between death and life in this visual metaphorical way. This is for an organization called Kids Unique, who work with the disadvantaged youth in New York, and that was for the volunteer campaign. And I was thinking what to do, and I thought, well, these kids spend a lot of time on the street because they come usually from broken families. And like the little trees in New York that need the support of the two posts, maybe they need that too to bloom and to grow. So I made it into a young kid, like a blooming tree. Climate change, something maybe that we experience now, you know, snowing and raining in one part and drought in another part. And you see that, I mean, I mentioned a few times the visual metaphor, but you see I often would replace something that looks like something, but it has the completely opposite meaning, and then you have the message. So here the fish, the scales are the cracked earth, and it's water, but actually lack of water. This was, if you remember, a couple of years ago when the big tsunami hit Indonesia and hundreds of thousands of people died in a day or two. And then a month after that, the Design Society of Indonesia approached me and asked me to visualize these words, hope for Indonesia. And I thought nature can kill, but nature can recover. There is hope, like the way the tail of the lizard grows back. So that's what I did. And these are the colors of the Indonesian flag. So I have pictures they printed. It was a very popular image in Indonesia at that time. Something I did for a book, Love, spelled with the human shapes, the essence of human life, and something that, like I already said, I enjoy a lot, playing with forms, seeing different possibilities of transforming things and just imagining things. That I love my job, I can say. I mean, I can draw all the time and come up with different combinations all the time. Something for, in France, they had this presidency of the European Union a couple of years ago, and they came up with an interesting project. They asked a couple of artists to visualize the word walking. And I thought walking is from, like, physical, from point A to point B, but walking is inside your mind. And that's what I did, someone who is climbing the steps inside their head. And it was displayed at the airports in Paris, like that. Another project for the Design Biennial in Saint-Étienne in France. A group of American artists participated, and the theme for our presentation was Value Meal. And each artist interpreted the issue of fast food and the food as a commodity. And I decided to build this trash box that we see in the fast food chains. And that ironically has the word thank you, if you think how much food we waste in the Western world. And I replaced the covers on the paper, no, plastic trays with some of my images. Again, showing the contrast between food for us, for the developed world, and for the people who don't have it. But also not so much when I think about this project now, there are so many people in this country who also are starving. So things always come back, and we are all interdependent. So what's happening in Sudan, it's happening here as well. So that's the Sudan poster with McDonald's, like burger. This was fun because it's about the genetically modified food, how we pay so much more for organic, but the food is already genetically modified, and we don't know how that's going to affect us. And why we modify the food genetically? Because we want more and more and more. So we want to squeeze more and more and more from nature. So that's something very dangerous in that. Wonder Bread, I just scanned a piece of bread and removed the shape of Africa. Again, the food that we can buy in a plastic bag and someone else has only the empty hole inside. So this is it for today. And I thank you very much. And I'll be happy to answer your questions. And thank you again. Thank you for listening. Thank you for spending the afternoon here. I think I'm on time. I don't know if I went too fast or too slow, but that's it. Thank you.